Hallelujah. We greet you all in the blessed name of Yahshua HaMashiach. And I do Baruch Brach Ar Abba. Full of the excellence of his blessing, somewhat a torrid pace this evening to prepare myself, but yet I'm prepared in the way that Yah instructs and commands me to teach us the simplicity of Torah delights, that our hearts may be fattened with his truth, and that we can rest in great assurance that we can rest upon the promises of what he has instructed us in. There are often times that my mind wanders and it scans the Torah, and there are certain words that arises in my heart that I think that I understand, but literally my ignorance shines forth like a bright light, and I realize that the lack and the inabilities I have, so I must trust on Almighty Yahweh for all things. And some weeks ago, there was a word that constantly resonated in my mind. It was the word stead, S-T-E-A-D, steadfast. We've heard that used in many applications, and what it implies, and the definitive of it. And I am of such ignorance that I must search out the root of all things so that I can understand the simple things. I don't like complex things. I like things to be easy. I don't like complicated things. I like the easy things. I like to find the easiest way to do it. So I want to teach tonight on that word, steadfast. And I certainly do want to use some of the most reputable resources that are available unto us, that I want to define that and give us definitions, so that when we read in Torah and see what this word characterizes, we often hear it quoted by Zachin ben Amin, but in a different aspect. I want to define that, first of all, by the World's College Dictionary. It is an adjective. And it means this: when you find one that say that one is steadfast, this is what it is. It implies one that is fixed in intensity. Now, we may say we are steadfast, but there must be an intensity there. There must be a level of aggression. It is fixed. It cannot be moved. It is fixed in intensity. And also the purpose or direction. It knows where it is going, and one's mind is sealed on that objective. Nothing at all removes that mind or that heart away from the intensity of that objective. It also means to be very steady, unwavering, or determined in purpose. You don't shift, you're unwavering, and there is a pronounced determination of the purpose, and nothing impedes, nothing circumvents one from ascertaining or getting to that goal. It consists of a loyal ruach, a loyal spirit. It is loyalty. It is also faithfulness. And above all, it is not unmovable, but immovable. Nothing moves it. Nothing destroys it. Nothing calls it to fade from its purpose. It is also unswavering. It doesn't sway back and forward. It is unwavering. It is unflattering. It needs no flattering or anything to solidify the firmness of the purpose in one's heart. It is also stable, very stable. It is not dual purpose of mind, but single-minded. It is unflinching. It doesn't flinch. In the avenue of adversities and different oppositions, And it is very resolute. The purpose is there, the resolution, and nothing alters that at all. And this is what captivates me concerning the word steadfast, because we read it, and yet I have searched every singular scripture and those that are associated with this word. It has one implication, because I will give us the definitive out of the Hebraic lexicon. It says that it is dedicated. And so when one is steadfast, you find one that is dedicated, and they are dependable. Yeah, all of these superlatives express the very beauty of Yah, Yeshua HaMashiach, the Torah of Yah. And it gives us great characterization as to what that word steadfast implies. But there are three valuable components of it that, from the Hebraic expression, all of these superlatives do express in a more detailed fashion what it means in the Hebraic. But I want to read this. This is not my definitive, but this is what, from the resources of those that are students and that have laid the foundation for me to understand this hundreds of years ago. The word steadfast, and I will give us the Hebraic expression of the word. In general, one may identify only three basic components of the meaning of this word, what this word means. And these three components always interact. These three components are, they are in great close relationship with each other. It represents strength, the steadfastness, and love, ahava. As I said, we often hear Zachin Benjamin use the word chasad, chasad. There is nowhere in the Torah of Yah, when the word steadfast is used, that it does not apply to these three components. And above all that, it applies to the love kindness of Almighty Yahweh. Our love kindness cannot be something that is wavering, unstable. There is doubt. But it must be a firm resolution in our hearts and in our minds. As I stated, I have studied every single verse in Torah, the writings of verses before and after, to get a composition of the value of this great word. It also, at any understanding of the word that fell, now this is what the Hebraic lexicon suggests. In order for us to grasp the word steadfast or chasid, it says any understanding, any knowledge, any discernment of this word that fails to incorporate, to interact, or suggest all three of these components, it is inevitably lost, and it has lost the richness of the implication of that word. And these are the three words that this word, steadfast, always express. It is the strength of Yisrael and the reliability upon the nation, each body part, that is vitally important, and that there is a steadfast connection there, and it based in the premises of Yah's great love. It cannot be based upon anything else but these three great components. And as I searched the Torah, I identified every book in Torah as to where this word is applied. I would have begun here in one verse in the book of Devarim, but in every book where there's Bereshit, Shemoth, Vayiram, Bimidbar, This is vital to understand here in Devarim, Deuteronomy chapter 7 and verse 12. Yah says unto the nation, his people, wherefore it shall come to pass, this is what shall come, or bow, it shall enter into our hearts and our minds, in our conscience, it shall come to pass, first of all, if we listen. We must learn how to listen to what? To the judgments, the mishpatim, the judgments of Almighty Yah, and then we must shema, we must guard them. We must keep them. And the only reason that we listen to the judgments of Yah, to guard them, to keep them, is for this resolution. And that is to asa, to do them, to fashion ourselves according to the mandate and the writs of Torah. We listen to judgment to apply it to our hearts. That's why we listen. If you don't listen to judgment, you will never apply it to your heart. You will never guard yourself against that thing that opposes Yah. And when you do that, then you must do them. To asa, to fashion your life in accordance to the judgment that is written in the Torah. And when one begins to do that, for this purpose, that Yah your Abba shall keep you in the brit, in the covenant relationship with him, and the steadfast love kindness which he has sworn to your Abba. That is the only way that we're going to have the strength of his love kindness, or the strength and the character of his chassid, is that we must listen to the judgments of Yah, to do them, to fashion ourselves accordingly, and then we will begin to sense the great chassid, the great love kindness, and the steadfastness of Yah's faithfulness unto us. You take a child that doesn't listen to the judgment of one's parent or parents, then they don't sense and they cannot calculate the very intensity of the mother's love, of the father's love, and that steadfast love kindness. Judgment always brings strength. It always builds character. It always produces substance. And it calls you that when you see the resolution of the matter, the one that judged you, it calls you to have a great chassid for them, because you see the resolution. And you know that what they said, it was purposeful, and it was beneficial to me. And one that is ignorant of that and unlearned it, they could never understand that. So that is how we literally procure the great steadfastness of Yah's great love kindness. It is a love that overwhelms us, that we pledge our allegiance unto him. And then in doing that, we see the results of that, because we know that he is faithful. He is reliable. He is unwavering. He doesn't change. He is not tossed to and fro by the winds that frightens us, because nothing frightens him. So we must be stable in the steadfastness of his love kindness and in the ability to trust him for all resolutions. There was one mother named of Ruth. The Torah, I want to read this in the book of Ruth. Beautiful daughter of Zion that loved Yah. And this is on the account of her. Boaz realized that she had no husband, man, but he was last in line to procure her. And it was her beauty that resonated, her love kindness that caused him to be drawn unto her. Young daughters, it is not your filthy, stinking nakedness. It's not that. It is greater than that. And so it says here in the writings of the book of Ruth, chapter 3, verse 10, This is what Boaz said to her, and he said, "Blessed be you of Almighty Yah. You are rich with a great Oshir, the riches of his faithfulness. You're reliable. You are one that is resourceful." So he says, "Blessed be you of Yah." He called her a bath, a daughter of Zion. "For you have shown more steadfastness, chesed, love kindness in the latter end, in the chetz, in the latter end than at the beginning. Insomuch as you follow not," listen, "you don't follow young men, whether they are rich or poor. That is the power of your steadfast love kindness." And that is what we need. We need the chesed of Yah, that we may become more reliable. We are steady in our walk. We don't waver over the smallest of matters. You don't pursue and follow those things that you believe that will give you some form of satisfaction to your flesh. And he saw the beauty of Ruth, that she did not follow the young men, whether they were rich or whether they were poor. She was not trying to secure or procure any man. And she was blessed with a mighty man, a man of beauty, a man of strength. And he represents the very favor and the very fragrance of Almighty Yahweh. That's what he represents. Because he had power to take life. He had power of riches. And he saw her love kindness, that it was chesed. She was faithful. She was steady. She was not wavering, unmovable, because she loved the judgments of Yah. She understood the great beauty of Yah's judgment and the purpose of Yah's judgment. And she kept those things in her heart. And she practiced those things to fashion her, that she was noticed when those that were much more physically attracted than her, she had a beauty, the love kindness, the chesed of Yah, that superseded all the physical activities. When her sister-in-law had to choose between the road that Yah had paved or her desire, Oprah, she chose to go a different route. And she showed her love kindness to her mother-in-law. And because of that, it produced the great love kindness of Almighty Yahweh. And we, as the woman of Yah, Yisrael, we must begin to operate in that ruach of Almighty Yah. And the only way you're going to get the depth of that, you must understand and appreciate the judgments of Yah. And then once you do that, you must begin to listen. You must begin to shemach. The first thing we do when we judge, we become very antsy and angry and hostile. And we begin to pose anything that I've always found that silly. Because when there is something that assists me and helps me, I don't care whose mouth it comes out of, I can accept that. I can. And that's a fact. No, I'm not going to allow you to come here and set me straight. Never. I would allow them to do that. You may, but not you. And that's a fact. I won't allow it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Here's a great word of reverence, prayer unto Yah. Here in 2 Samuel. And by the way, the word is pronounced 12 times just in 1 Samuel, 11 times in Bereshit. I have it all here, but I want to teach from some the most prominent, and I found that all of the Chizvi, every scripture, was prominent, so I elected about 3 pages of them. I know I am not going to finish tonight, all right? Here's a profound prayer that David offered unto Yah for his great deliverance And for the abundance, as we were taught last Kitzvimat, the abundance of the riches, the berechaya, the blessings of Omariah. He says in 2 Samuel 22:50, he says, therefore I will give Toda, Yada, Yehuda unto Almighty Yah. He cries out, O Yahweh, I'm going to do that among the Goyim, or the Goyim, the nations, the heathens, the Gentiles. He says, I will offer up the Shiram, or the songs of praises, not to him, but to his name, his Hashem. I will sing the excellence and the beauty of the name of Almighty Yah among the nations of people. Why will you do this? Because, he says in the next verse, he is the tower, he is the strong one of my Yoshiach, my salvation for his anointed king. And this is what Yah shows us. And he shows us chasid, or steadfast love kindness, to his Mashiach. We are the Mashiach of Yah. We are the ones that he has spread the oil of anointing, the oil of gladness, that our hearts rejoice and we sing unto his excellent name. He has shown steadfast love kindness to his Mashiach David, and to his Zerah, the seed. He did not say for a dispensation of time, but he says evermore, le'olam vi'ad. There is no end. And even in the midst of our activities that are vile and repugnant, he shows us his love kindness. How? First of all, by setting forth the ruach of judgment. And he judged us to listen. And when we listen and do that, then we will see the greatness of his hasid, his great faithfulness, how steadfast Almighty Yahweh is, that in the midst of that we can enjoy his great kindness. There is nothing like kindness. Nothing like kindness. And to be kindly affectionate, we must do that one unto another. There's nothing like, Cole, listen to me. I know that I am a person that I may appear to be somewhat staunch and segregated, but that's not who I am. That is just a perception that you have developed or you perceive of me. But we must have that. I love the people of Yah. I will do nothing to harm them or do anything to impede their growth. I don't play or anything like that. Lady left a message the other day. Well, when I come, you see my smiling face. Well, you're not coming here to smile in my face. If you come, don't come here to play with me. When you see my smiling face, you will know that I'm this. I am. No, you won't even see my face. That's not the issue, whether you see my face. We must look upon his face and see his face. That's the most important thing, Yisrael. And there is nothing that this is the great beauty of Yah's steadfast. He is steadfast, unmovable. We must be that way. Showing love kindness, always abounding in what the, even in the very works of the mitzvuth of Almighty Yahweh in Yeshua HaMashiach. That's the great kindness of Yah's steadfastness, his great kindness, his strength, his maturity as the great one. If we listen to the judgments of Yah, we must stop despising when we are judged. We must stop that. It is a sign of immaturity. You look at children, they don't like that. But a wise man, he receives whatever the reproof is, because he knows and makes him wise and stronger that he does not venture into that era again. And we are people that just despise anything that opposes our will, and it's wrong. You will never grow. You will never understand the love kindness of Yah. So your embracing with each other will be unaffectionate. It will be cold, because there's something in our hearts, something in our minds. Because of vain iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax. It gets cold. It is not a love that enriches. When children understand their parents love them, parents know their children love them, it enriches the relationship. And that's what we are going to have, nation of Yah. And if we don't have that, then woe unto us. First Kings, First Melachim, chapter 3, verse 6. These are the great words of Shlomo. Listen to this, the wisest man on the face of the earth. And Shlomo said, he's speaking unto Yahweh. He said, you have shown, you have granted unto your Evet, your servant, and a servant is one that loves and is submissive with all faithfulness and obedience. You have shown unto your servant David, he says, he is my Avat. You showed unto him not just steadfast love, kindness, or Hasid, but he uses the superlative Gadol, great. Beyond numerical numbers, it is exceedingly powerful. It is of great substance and wealth. That is what Gadol is. Yah is Gadol, he is great. And so that is the power of the love kindness that he shows us in the book Yisrael. And the book corrects us and it sets us forth on the straight and the narrow path that brings the fullness of life, which is in the power of the testimony of Yahshua. We walk it and we live it. Not some little tricky of thing. Those things have no value in life. He said, you have shown him not just chasid. You have shown him great, steadfast love and kindness. According as he walked before you, what? In truth. We must walk in Torah. That's what truth is. For the Sodik, the righteousness of Yah, it is li'olam v'yad. It is an everlasting righteousness. And his Torah is truth. It is Emet. That is the truth. And as we walk according to the Torah, we will sense, we will be nurtured by the steadfast love kindness, the Hasid of Almighty Yahweh. And when we don't do that, then we're going to find this resistance. We're going to find this corruption that takes place in our minds, that we will resist that. We will resist that from Yah. That's why we resist any kind of correction and judgment for Yah, because we don't have that steadfast love kindness for him. We're not stable. We waver. We're happy one day and we're sad the next day. You know, I say all the time, not that I say that to myself to encourage me, because I am encouraged. Nothing makes me settle down in the dust of the earth because I'm discouraged. Nothing discourages me. Nothing. And that's the truth. But I say all the time, yeah, I'm so happy. I mean, I'm in the restroom and it's 86 degrees. How happy can you be? That's right. How happy can you really be? But I'm happy. I am really, really, really happy. I am. When I'm working, I'm happy. When I'm broke, and that's 99.9% of the time, I'm still happy. There is a great delight. There is a fulfillment in my heart that I rejoice in the Torah, in the truth of Yah. That makes me happy. I don't need money to be happy. And the ones that have money are not happy. They're not happy. I'm happy.
I mean that. I am happy. And that's a fact. And I will not allow anything to discourage me from that great delight in his truth. He said, according he walked before you in truth. He was a Sadiq man. He was uprightness in his love with you. He was genuine. His heart was sincere. He was right. He did not try to pretend, but he walked in uprightness, yasha. His heart was straight. He was straight up, as we would say it in the terminology of my days. Man, you must be straight up. And that's the way his heart, he was straight up with Yah. When he sinned, he knew he had sinned. He walked in uprightness of love with you, and you kept, and you have kept for him this great. This is what Yah stored up for David and those that would inherit the rights and the inheritance rights of the throne and of that lineage and that surety of the sure king, that you have set this great steadfast love kindness, that you have given him a son to sit on his throne as it is this day. It is your love kindness. And it is Yah's steadfast love kindness to Abraham, Yitzhak, and Jacob that will cause us, and we are the elect or the children of Israel. We are his people because of his promises. And it delights his heart to show us his great hasid. He is faithful. He is strong in his steadfastness. His love, because he is love. He is love. You know, there is no other love without Yah. It is a form of a practice that doesn't produce anything, but for we know that Yah is love. He is love. He is Ahava. He is the Ahab. And without him, there is no, you have no power to generate love. I know the world love their own in what they call love. They love each other. And they will shoot one another in the head and say, I loved him. I know how the world loves, but it is not the great love kindness and the great love of Almighty Yahweh that he has granted unto us. The prophet Ezra gives us great insight here in First Ezra chapter 3, verse 11. With the foundations of the tabernacle, and Yahshua has laid the foundation of the tabernacle of life for us. He speaks here in Ezra chapter 3, verse 11. It tells us, and they all began to sing, or they sang together by chorus in Hallelujah, and given Torah unto Yah. You could hear the sounds resonate from the crowds, everyone, and they were so synchronized as they began to sing Hallelujah to his name, oh precious he is. It was not some kind of dead song that we hear amongst the religious order, but it was one that caused the clouds of rejoicing to flow into the Shemayim of Yah, and they sing it by chorus. Everything was synchronized and organized. They had no director. They sang from the abundance of the fruitfulness of the love kindness of Yah that he had shown toward them as they laid the foundation to Beit or the house of Yah. And it says, and they gave Todah unto Yahweh because he is tough. That's why you sing. That's why you rejoice, because he is excellent. He is tough. For his hasid, his steadfast love kindness is forever. Li'olam viad, through antiquity, through eternity, there is no beginning and there is no end. That's why we sing the great choruses from our hearts unto Yah, and we rejoice in the abundance of his great riches and his blessings. Why? Because nothing stagnates his great, steadfast love, kindness, his hasid. Nothing. He is tough. He is wonderful as to us. He is kind, and his love kindness is forever toward who? His nation, Yisrael. How do you sense the greatness of Yah's love kindness? You will know his love kindness by this experience. Can I tell you? When you know that he judged you, when you know that he judged you, to correct you, to show you the greatness of his love kindness, because he can redeem us or he can damn us. That's when you know. And if he doesn't judge you, he doesn't correct you, then you know you are a bastard. You are a mamzer. You're far from his throne of kindness. He shows this toward us. And when they began to sing that song, it says, and all the people, they shouted, Gara, their voices resonated unto the heavens. And they shouted from the diaphragm that the veins on their necks protruded out. They all shouted with a great voice when they began to praise Yahweh. Why? Because the foundation, Yahshua is the foundation that has been laid in our labor, in our hearts, in our land. It has been laid there. And when you know that it's laid, it will cause you to shout and sing. You will become content with food and raiment, a change of clothing. He didn't even promise you that. When I see the world, when I see the conditions of those here in this nation, I have nothing to complain about. I don't complain if I work hard or if I don't work hard at all today. And I did not today because I know that there's a period of restoration because I got a hard drive ahead. And I'll get it done. I will finish the course. I will finish it. And there's no doubt about that, Yisrael. We must allow this fruit to produce in our lives, and we must allow the seed of his truth to be planted in our hearts. And that's why Yah raised up a prophet, Nobi, like Ezra, that he may speak words to us for this time and this moment, that we may search out that thing which is small in our eyes, that we give no thought to it. I give thought to each word. I don't look at things in a broad sense. When I study the Torah, I study one word at a time, and I teach that way. I preach that way. I can't do like other men. I am not as bright. I'm not as intelligent. I don't have the wherewithal. So that's why I take one little step at a time. I don't take two. I take one step at a time. So one word at a time, if I begin to understand that, then I can understand the breadth and the gravity of one that has made me. The prophet Nehemiah, he says to us here, Nehemiah chapter 5, chapter 1, I want to read. Nehemiah the prophet says in verse 5, just one verse. I want to try to go through some of these verses. I have a catalog of every verse. Not every verse, because there are 277 verses that deal with just this one topic. And the S-T-E-A-D-F-A-S-T. And then you will have S-T-E-D. That gives a different implication, and it implies differently than the steadfast or the hasset. It's totally different, all right? The prophet Nehemiah says, as he speaks unto Almighty Yahweh, Nehemiah chapter 1, verse 5, and he said, I beg of thee, I entreat you, O Yah. He says, I know that you are the sovereign ruler. There is no one over you. You are the master of the heavens, Hashem, I am. You are great again, Gadol. You are the great Almighty One. And you ought to be yira, or feared by us, and also kabod, or honored
esteem with much.
That keeps covenant. He keeps his brits, his allegiance. He guards that. That's what Shema is. He guards his covenant with his house. That's why when you see the word K-E-E-P with an S or keep, that means that Yah guards Shema. He guards it as though that one hedged with thorns. He protects it. He keeps covenant. And this is how he keeps covenant. And he keeps steadfast or chasid, steadfast love kindness for them that ahava him. And we that keep and observe his misvuth, the commandments of Yah. For we do that, there is nothing, Yisrael, that can destroy us. Death cannot destroy us. It does not separate us from the perfect plan of Yah. But when we show our great love unto Yah, and that is that we observe to do and to keep his commandments. When we are truly born again, we keep the commandments of Almighty Yahweh. That's the true experience of the birth of Yah and Yeshua HaMashiach. And in the power of that man, Yeshua, he gives us that strength. He gives us that strength through the veil of this flesh that was always opposed, that could not be corrected. And he corralled it all in that body. And what he did, he took upon all our sins. That's the love kindness of Yah. That's how his steadfast love kindness, he has guarded his covenant with the forefathers that he cannot lose one. Because by his immutability, he has said it, it shall come to pass, it shall manifest itself. He cannot speak a shekha, he cannot lie. He cannot. So his word must be manifest, not only in the body of Yeshua, but it must be manifest in us. So he keeps that. He guards his steadfast, his chasid, his faithfulness, his love, his obligation unto us. He guards that if we love him. And we know that we know him and we love him if we guard, if we keep Shema, his commandments. We don't do that, then we don't love Yah. He will not show us love kindness if we don't do what he commands us to do. And that's the truth. It's a beautiful verse that flourished when I read it in the book of Esther. When he talks about the king, his great love for Esther, chapter 2 and verse 17. He says, and the melech, the king, loved Esther. He loved her, just like the mighty king loves us. Esther chapter 2, verse 3. And the king loved Esther above all the women. He loved no other one. That's how he loves you, above all. Nothing supersedes me. And we all can see that. He loved that woman. That's why Yah loves his assembly. He loves his house above all women. There's no woman. He doesn't love the Muslim woman. He doesn't love the Hindu woman. He loves Yisrael. He loves that woman, his bayit. And the king loved Esther. She was the bright star of his life above all the women. And because of that, she secured, she obtained favor and steadfast love kindness in his sight more than all, listen now, all the virgins. Even the Beth-Ula, the ones that were pure, had not been contaminated by some man. He loved this woman. And that's why Yah loves this woman more than any other woman. And he shows
them and he shows them, we obtain the steadfast love kindness, the chesed of Yah, more than any people on the face of the earth. Those that declare that they are pure by their own rituals and their own righteousness, he loves this woman above all women. So that the king, he set his royal crown upon her head, and he made her queen instead of Vashti. Yah has made us kings and rulers in his kingdom. He has set the crown of life upon our heads. And that crown is the beauty and the honor of Yahshua HaMashiach. That they see the lights that resonate from Arush, from Aman, the lights of Torah, the light of his wisdom, the light of his knowledge, Yisrael. And he loved her above. That's why he loves you above. The virgin women, those that are pure and think they are right in their own eyes and they have their own rituals and their own self-righteousness. Yet I have failed, you have fallen and come short of the great expectation and the beauty of Almighty Yahweh. We have nafon, we have fallen. We have fallen down before him, even in our repentance, that we're not very fruitful. But yet we have fallen, Yisrael. And that is of great importance, that we may experience the great love kindness or the chesed of our faithful Abba, that will show forth the excellence of his great love kindness. Who experienced the gravity of great agony more than Eyob, Job? But listen to what Job says here, Eyob. Job chapter 1 and the very first verse. Chapter 10 and verse 12. Eyob 10:12. In the midst of all of his great agony of pain, this is vitally important. In the midst of all of the great agony of his affliction, the great pain, the trials of his mind, his friends, those that were in close companionship with him, this is what he says unto the Abba. You have nothing, you have granted, you have bestowed me. He said life, not just chay, but chayil, strength, the ability, the power to trust and to obey. You have granted me life. He said your great chesed, steadfast. It doesn't move. Steadfast love kindness and your visitation. He said, Yah, that is what has preserved my ruach. Well, when does Yah visit us? Well, we come in his name. And there are at least three of us here. You that have joined us, where two or three are gathered in his name, there shall he also be in the midst of that people. And so he is in the midst of us tonight, Yisrael. This is his visitation to show us the greatness of his steady, unwavering love kindness, his chesed that secures us to be faithful and dedicated unto him as he is unto us. We are the body of Yahshua. We cannot do the body wrong. We cannot impose those things that are unlawful upon the body to cause detriment. We can't do that. It's wrong. In the midst of all of my agony, Eyob said that you have caused life to be bestowed upon me. And in that, it is your great steadfast love kindness. And it is because you have visited me. How did he know that Yah had visited him? For every son that Yah receives, every daughter, he corrects and he chastens them or he judges them.
And he is going to judge us. This is not just once in a while. It is a daily, hourly. It is a minute. It is a second. It is a minute. It is a daily. It's an hour. It is a daily. It is a process that continues. It doesn't take very long for our minds to become inundated with filth, does it? We find ourselves thinking on things that are so far removed. We sit here and our minds are so far away from Yah as it is the stars from the earth. He's not in our minds, in our thoughts. It is just a process that we have become so accustomed to. But there is no great love for him or great steadfast love kindness toward him. I've always said to us over the many years, I find the writings of David, Yochanan, and John, I find those writings, not that every book doesn't present the very intimacy of Yah, but those books and the writings of David in a way that is much more climactic than Yochanan, than the writings of Shaul because of the different circumstances. But to me, it is a heartfelt, if I may use that expression, it is an experience of the heart. And they're just, everyone goes to the writings of Tehillim, Psalms. I mean, if you can't read anything, you read that. I mean, the book of Mishli, in the proverbial sense of the Mashal, of the great mysteries, of the great wisdom of his speech, that's excellent. The whole book is excellent. But it's something about that writing that deals with this intimacy of Yah in the midst of every kind of circumstance. I don't care what funeral you go to, you're going to read Psalms 23. I don't care what house, what people. The inspiration always comes from the great, eloquent writing, the verbiage of David, because he was moved by the Ruach of Yah. And there are some verses here I want to read here in Tehillim. And that one word, it is expressed 125 times just here in the writings of David. I experience every verse of it. And to understand the captivation of one verse, you may have to go five or six verses and read down to understand that, and five or six down to understand the intricates of that. When it comes to the word of Yah, I'm not lazy on that. I'm lazy in a lot of things, but that I'm not lazy in. I'm not one that will not pick up the writs and the direction of my life once in a while. I'm not one that will stop doing what has gotten me where I am today. I will not do that. No, this is what's going to keep me and preserve me. And I'm not about to put this down because of some kind of an emotional, dysfunctional processing of things in my mind. You can, but I will not. Not me. David speaks here in a profound way to Tehillim, Psalms chapter 6 and verse 4. In the midst of the great agonies of his battles, he says to Yashub, turn. He says to Yah, return, O Yahweh. And he asks him to deliver my nephesh. Oh, deliver me. For only one reason he asked Yah. He said, not because of my fears, the trepidation of the agony that I am experiencing. He says, oh, deliver me, for let this be the reason for your steadfast love kindness or your chasid sake. Deliver me because of your great love for me. Now, because of the agonies of the pains, and in the midst of all of our agony, in the throes of our pain, this should be our prayer. Deliver me, yeah, just for your love kindness. Not because I need to, I deserve it, but because of your steadfast love kindness. And that was his cry unto the Abba. Deliver me, set me free, return shub. My sins have gone up before me. But I know that you're able to deliver me. And when a man, we began to understand the derech that we're on, the way we walk, or the halach,
the process that we're on, then we'll understand what is there for us. And this is what David informs us, not some, but he says in Psalms, Tehillim 25, Tehillim chapter 25, Tehillim 25 and verse 10, he says, all, not some, he says, all the paths of Yah, listen, he did not say some of the paths, but he said all, the path of trials, the path of abundance, as we were taught, the path of affliction, the path of much, the path of trials, or the path of plenty. It makes no difference the path that we're walking on. He says all are the paths. That's plural. There is a S there. All the paths of Almighty Yahweh, they are chesed. They are steadfast, love, kindness, and truth. To who? To such as that Shema, that keep his covenant, and they have and they keep the testimony of Yeshua HaMashiach. I don't care what path we're on, whether there are afflictions, whether the path induce us to great trials, or a path where there's an abundance of ecstasy and great rejoicing. They all are full of the steadfast love, kindness of Yah, and also Torah, revelation, wisdom, and truth. If we keep covenant and we keep the testimonies of Almighty Yahweh, you know, this world is trying to denounce the testimony of Yeshua HaMashiach. How can that be? A man born of a woman that came to be the Yashaka? But yet they can believe now the world was made by this intelligent one and created the very procedures of the world and life and wondered that, but yet they find that somewhat hard to believe. I don't. I find it to be truth. I find it to be so that I've invested everything that I'm not in it. Because anything that I am, he is the one that has brought it forth. So I have nothing of myself to invest. I just give back what he is given. I don't do the excellent job in giving back, but I just, as the old folks would say, put it in his hands. And everything shall be all right. That is all the paths of Yah. That is our assurance and security. You're going through trials or tribulation, but the path there is steadfast love, kindness. Let us just keep covenant. Let us keep the promises of Yah and trust Him. Don't forsake that. Don't deny it. Yeah. And when there is a great rejoicing and the songs of rejoicing, then on that path, the same thing. Yah doesn't change. He is love. He doesn't change Yisrael. He is consistent. He is steady. He is unwavering. He is faithful. He is strong. He is dedicated. That's what chesed is. He's all of that. And a man that could speak with that kind of spiritual intellect and insight, he also can speak this way as well, Tehillim 33. I found it kind of difficult to get out of the writings of the steadfast love kindness out of Psalms, because there, as I said, 123 times that just this word or the combinations are written here. David says here in Psalms, Tehillim 33:18. He says, I want you to understand that the eyes or the ayin, the ozin of Yah, they are upon them that fear him. We must reverence, respect. We must tremble at Yah. I don't know about you, but I recall some years back, we had a pretty healthy herd of cows back then. And this is the time of the year we get some of those massive thunderstorms here. And we had a rain, and it was thundering Ever since that lightning laid hold to me, when I hear the thundering, I kind of do like Granny would do in the days when I was a lad. They would pull down all, close the curtains and everything, turn the lights off, and we would sit there in the center of the floor until the storm passed away. That's how we did it. And sometimes it's still wise to do that. It made our conscience to be reverence. We didn't know the power of Yah, but we knew that that was just not something that was happening. And it made us cognate of that, not what nature presented, but what Yah was talking about. And there was no noise in the house. The house was quiet. And I recall one year about this time of the year, maybe a little later, this time, July, August, we had a nice herd of cows out there. And the next morning we get up, it was thundering and lightning. It was fearful. You want to turn the lights out, and then you lay down, you somewhat intimidated because it's crackling near your head and you could see the flash of lightning. And the cows, they were under a tree. And the lightning hits the ground, and it killed six of them instantly, just fried them from the inside out. All of those cows. And I thought about that. I said, oh, yeah, I'm glad that I was in the house, not out here in the field, because if it killed those big beasts, that's why he sends the thunders. And those are the things on his treasure chest. One day, I will teach that one day. And these are the treasures of his chest. So when he sends the thunder, is that something that we mock or laugh? It is for us to understand his authority and his power. So David said that the eyes of Yah upon those that fear him. Upon them we must have tikvah. We must rely upon the promises of Yah, that upon them that have that tikvah, that we have assurance in his steadfast love kindness, or his assurance in his chasid. We must have assurance in the great love of Yah and the kindness of his love. Not that we were some kind of a special people, but he elected us to make us a sugula, a special people, a preference. We sin like anyone else, but it is his steadfast, his chasid, that covers our sins, Yisrael. So these are the elements that we must have in our hearts. We must have the fear of Yah, and then we must have tikvah. We must have, quote, hope, unquote, to bring clarity to the word tikvah. We must rely upon the promises of Yah, knowing that they are established in the steadfast love kindness of Yah, that he cares for us, and these things shall come to pass, not because we have deserved it, but he has made us to deserve it because of his steadfast love kindness. And once we began to understand that, the richness of his power and his understanding will flow in our minds. And nothing, I know it may be difficult for people to believe that there is nothing, though, that caused me to become unmoved, whereby I want to move away from Yah or try something else. Nothing at all. I don't care if I was broke, and I'm broke. I may have $200 or $300 on me, but it's not for me to spend it. Well, I see something that's going to benefit the community, and that's what I take advantage of. That's what I do. And that's how I spend the money. That's just the truth. That's how I spend it. And that's a fact. Hallelujah. So we must have this tikvah in his steadfast love, kindness, understanding the promises of Yah. And once we do that, then this is what will bring forth out of us Tehillim, again, Psalms 59:16. This is what will bring forth. that we said, but I will sing. I will sing of the top of Yah. He said, I will sing of your great power. Yes. He said, I will sing aloud. Not only will I sing of your great power, Psalms 59 verse 16. He said, not only will I sing of your great power, but I will also make the Shiram, the songs of delight, of your steadfast love, kindness in the morning. He woke me up this morning and he started me on the Torah way. He did. I don't care what your circumstances may be, but if you get up with that kind of sheer song in your heart, I'm going to sing. I don't care how I sound. I'm going to sing. I don't care who don't like the way I sing. I'm going to sing. I don't care about notes. I don't care about lyrics. I sing what the book represents. I don't know any songs. I cannot write a song. Every song that I sing, it just comes and it flows that way. I don't pen no lyrics. They just flow. My experience have taught me that. But thy weed, he says, Yah, I will sing of your power. Not only will I sing of that, then he says, yes, chen, absolutely. I will sing aloud now. He said, I will sing of your power. But he said, I will sing aloud of your steadfast love, kindness in the morning. And so when you get up, if I'm grumpy, you're singing. You're singing. I will sing loud in the morning of your great love kindness. Why? For you have been my defense and my refuge in the day of trouble. You tell me his steadfast love kindness was there in the day of trouble? It was his steadfast love kindness that defended him? He said, you have been my defense. Your steadfast love kindness, your hasad, has been my refuge, my place of comfort in the midst of all of my agonies. That's why when I get up in the morning, I'm going to sing aloud. And I want the world to hear me sing. I don't care what the world says, how the sound of my voice, it makes no difference at all. Why? Because your steadfast love kindness has been there with me during the midst of all of these great agonies. And then he says in another place, because I will, Psalm 63 and 3. This is why he sings. And that's why he said what he said there in Tehillim 59. But in chapter 63, verse 3, he says, with all of that, because your steadfast love kindness, it is better than life. I'd rather have that none to be living. I can go to the bank of life with the steadfast love kindness of Yah. He says, for your, listen, Yisrael, if we ever come to the wisdom of this, he says, your steadfast love kindness, your chasid, is better than life. My lips, my faith shall with a loud voice. Nothing is going to stop me. I shall praise you, Yah. I shall lift my voice to the heavens above and sing of the steadfast love kindness of Yah. It is better than life. It is. The steadfast love kindness is better than life. Reading each verse and those verses, each one was applicable for. And this was just a process of me electing some. I like the way they flow. I have not looked to see how they would flow.
So I haven't taken time, and this I did, I don't know, I think last week or week before last. I wanted to teach this tonight, all right? It is His great steadfast love kindness, and that great love kindness that I will sing aloud unto you. He says, because there's a reason I'm going to sing. You know what happened to David? This is what happened. He tells the chronology of this process. This is what happened to him. Psalms to Helium 85:10. He says, this is why. He says, I want to tell you what, Yah, in the midst of my great trials. Psalms 85:10. He said, Hasid, steadfast love, kindness, and truth, your Torah beauty has met together. They have met up with each other. I understood truth, but I didn't understand the dynamics of the steadfast love kindness of it. And all of a sudden, they met in one place. Steadfast, the Hasid of Yah, and the Emet, they met together. And it's nothing like meeting a friend that's a friend of friends. And when they come together in one bed, in one house, he said they met together. He said, and not only that, righteousness. I knew it was Sadiq, and I could walk in the Sadiq of Yah. He says, and the shalom, the covenant of great shalom of Yah. He said, they kiss each other. That's all right. There ain't nothing like a sweet kiss, is it? Little baby child give you a kiss, nothing like that. Talk to me. He said they met together and they kiss each other. There was great love and a love affair for all. His love kindness, his truth, his covenant of great shalom for us as a nation, Yisrael, and the righteousness of every action that he allows our lives to encounter. We should rise every morning singing to him with the voice of Torah, voice of gladness, because there are things that Yah is surrounded by. And David, as he would sing of the greatness of Yah, he would see the visions of these things, and he gives us an insight here in Psalms 89, verse 14. Again, it goes back to judgment. He tells us that justice and judgment are the habitation of the throne of Almighty Yahweh. Yah is just. He is straight. And judgment, these are the living components of his throne, his kisi. He says, steadfast love, kindness, or chasid and truth, it shall go before your face. That's what goes before the ponim of Yah's face. Steadfast love, kindness, and the great truth of Almighty Yah. That's what goes. Even in the midst when he sees all of our wickedness and our sins, his throne is covered with justice and judgment. That's why he judged us. And in judging us, he reminds us of whom he is. And then in the midst of all of that, when he could eviscerate us from off of the face of the earth, then it is the steadfast love, kindness. It is the chasid of Yah. It is Yah's great kindness that goes before his face, Yisrael. And it is the great beauty of Torah that goes before his face. That's what stays in the presence of Yah. You know that, come on. I've known that, said Yah, should have been me. I've always thought among my brothers, honestly, I was the least, I was the most worthless one, and I was sure that I would be the first one that died. That's just the honest truth. I didn't see myself living out a life that I've reached to this day. But once truth came in, that was a different story. I was just ignorant, didn't know. But that's the way our thoughts. Hallelujah.
Yah had his hands on me. And that's all that matters. That's all that matters.
It is one thing that Yah always zechah, he remembers. In our battles and our trials and our discontent, he remembers this. Psalms 98:3. In the midst of all of his great anxiety with us, I'm so glad he remembers this. When my sins flow to the heavens like the stench of a vile odor, that he says this in Psalms 98:3. He has remembered his steadfast love kindness, his hasad, and his truth, his Torah toward Beit Yisrael. All the ends of the earth have seen the Yoshiach, the salvation of our Yahweh. He remembers that, Yisrael. He remembers his love kindness. He is steadfast. It is reliable. It is strong. It brings assurance to our hearts. That's why we must, as the Torah commands us, we have opportunity. We must do right by all men. I don't care who they are. That does not mean you allow them to abuse you. No man is going to abuse me, because I will tell him, you're not going to do that. Period. We should do special by his people. We should. That should make our hearts fat when we do special things for his people. That's what makes me happy. That's what makes me rejoice. That's the truth. I don't need nothing. Nothing. I don't need toys. My diet is simple. You will not eat the way I eat. Believe me. It's simple. I don't need much. Period. It's his steadfast love kindness.
And the kindness of that. I want to read a few verses before I close. Bear with me. Psalms chapter 113, verse 11. This is to give us an exact measurement of his great love kindness. Now, when you can measure this, tell me, and then I will understand the depths of this. That's why I'll continue to read it. Psalms 103, verse 11. For as the Hashemam, the heavens, is high above the earth, so great, so great. Psalms 103, verse 11. I don't know how far the earth is above the heavens, but as high as the earth is above the heavens, so great is his steadfast love kindness, his hasad, toward them that fear him. That's how great his love is toward us, his great strength, his steadiness, his favor with us. As high as the earth is from the heaven, that's how great his steadfast love kindness. I don't know how high that is. I am not a mathematician. I am not a physics. I don't know. And I could not understand even the dimension of numbers if you told me that. I can't understand what a million is. I have no idea to grasp that. I don't. I can understand what a million miles, what that constitutes. You may. I don't, all right? So that's how great his steadfast love kindness is to us, as high as the heavens. I'll tell you what, my sins have filled between that space 10,000 times over. But his steadfast love kindness is greater than the magnitude of all of that Yisrael. And for that, it gives us reason of security and assurance. Psalms 108, verse 4, for your steadfast love kindness is great above the heavens, and your truth reaches to the clouds. That's where his truth reaches. His steadfast love kindness, his hasid, it is great above the heavens, and his truth reaches to the clouds. This is what we all must do. I'm going to close at this verse here. Let us all, Psalms 130 verse 7, Tehillim 130 verse 7, let Yisrael tigvar, wait in the midst of agony, pains, and trials. That's what tigvar is, the ability to endure. And you know that the promise is sure. You hoping don't get that. But the tigvar lets Yisrael tigvar, where? In Almighty Yahweh. For with Yahweh, for with him only, is steadfast, chasid, love kindness, and with him, that's the only place there's plenteous in redemption. No other place, plenty of redemption. Through all of the agonies of our sins, he's plenteous to forgive us of our sins. Steadfast, chasid. Let us rely upon him and his truth and the promises that are written in the book. And we shall be strong warriors of God. Yavaruch, may he strengthen you all this. Mpitzvei Imet, you that have joined us via the live stream. We pray that the broadcast was a blessing to you. Hallelujah. So may he enrich you all. May he bless you, Yisrael, and cause your hearts to be made fat. I'm going to allow my heart to eat the great dainties of Torah. Let us stand to our feet. Bless you all, Israel. Hallelujah. In all things we do, Baruch you for your great blessings. Bless us all and guide us, teach us. Let this word settle in our bosom. In Yahshua's name, we turn to you for all things, for your rich, blessed assurance. In Yahshua's name, heal us, I pray. Hallelujah. 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 Yabarak Israel.